The European Patent Office podcasts bring you an insight into the technology and innovation shaping the world.
Hello, my name is Nigel Clarke, and I'm happy to introduce the next in our podcast series. And today we have Orla Feeney. She's going to tell us a little bit about herself, the job, the challenges, the excitements, and other aspects of what she does. Orla, good morning.
Good morning, Nigel.
How are you today?
Very well, thank you.
Can you just tell us a little bit about yourself, what you studied, where, and how you came to join the EPO?
Well, I started my studies in Dublin. I did a degree in applied physics, master's in optoelectronics in Belfast. And from there, I took off to the Canary Islands, where I worked for a while at an astronomical observatory.
Somebody's got to do it, I suppose.
Indeed, the times were hard back then. I worked on the Canary Islands. There are some observatories with ground-based telescopes. So I worked for a while building optical instruments for those telescopes to improve the quality of the images that can be taken with those telescopes. Following from that, I did some PhD studies building a prototype instrument called a wavefront sensor, which is part of an adaptive optics system, which again has a focus of improving the quality of ground-based telescopes to maybe give them a resolution which is comparable, or at least that's the goal of something like the Hubble Space Telescope.
So you worked with essentially large centralized facilities.
Indeed, yes. Many people may have seen these observatories. There's up on the top of the mountain in El Teide in Tenerife, and in La Palma, the El Roque de los Muchachos, there are six or seven, or I don't know, in the meantime, maybe of that order of ground-based telescopes, which are run by scientific collaborations between European scientific institutes.
So are you working in the field of telescopes right now?
Well, I work in the field of optics, so optics and optical apparatus, optical systems. So, of course, I had a very good, I came equipped with a lot of knowledge from my studies and from the work experience and my PhD studies to work in the field G02B, it's called, which is a very broad field covering all aspects, really, of optical apparatus and systems.
So the inventions you see, are they consumer goods? Are they scientific apparatus? Are they industrial products?
Well, definitely a combination of all of those. I mean, we can start with things like lighting in your home. Nowadays, there's a trend, you know, to move towards LED light sources, which is not the part that I examine. What we examine, so LEDs are an attractive substitute for tungsten filament bulbs, which we had previously, because they're more energy efficient. The disadvantage of LEDs is that they're a point light source, and for our lighting needs, we often need various shapes of illumination. So an important area that we deal with is lenses for which are used with LEDs to produce illumination for the home, illumination for street lighting, also for car headlights, for example. These lenses, which are used to shape the light from LEDs, that's an important area.
So LED is light-emitting diode, right?
Yes, an LED is a light-emitting diode, which is a point-like source. So it's minuscule. It's a small light source. So it won't give enough light necessarily to light your interiors, to in the use of street lighting or headlights. So in order to make the lighting coming from LEDs, make it more usable for all different types of applications, the LEDs are used with lenses. These are special lenses which shape the beam that comes out of an LED.
So these LEDs, are they brighter than incandescent lights, for example? Brightness, you know, meaning the intensity of the light they emit.
Well, yes, they can be. Well, they're used you have a matrix, so an array of LEDs. It has the advantage that you can get whatever wavelength of light out that you want, so maybe a softer light towards the blue region of the visible spectrum. So Yes, indeed. You can maybe tune the light better that you get out of the light source. That's a real advantage.
So in the, let's say, as you say, these are point sources of light. But if you want, let's say, a large diffuse light source, you have to use an array, right?
Correct. And then you use an array of the light sources, and then you use an array of lenses too with a particular shape. I mean, you know what a lens is, so you have a particular shape on the surface, so maybe more curved. Don't forget that for street lighting, for example, or for car headlights, there are certain norms that the lighting has to fulfill. So the lens plays an important role there in producing the light pattern or the illumination pattern that you want in order to provide sufficient light and a shape that you need in order to fulfill the norms required.
So I assume there's other advantages of LEDs over other forms of lighting. So maybe energy consumption?
Yes, indeed. Yes, although I must say that LEDs themselves, in order to be strict about it, the LED itself is in a different technical field. So in my technical area, we take care of the lenses in all the different shapes and sizes to shape the light beam coming out of the LED. But the LED itself and that technology is in a different technical field, so to speak.
So you're really concerned, as you said, with optical elements. So these are what, refractive and reflective optics?
Exactly, that's right. So refraction being bending of light. Light goes from a medium of a given refractive index into different medium, for example, glass, like in a lens. Well, the light gets bent. And this is the basis for all optical systems. Different media, different refractive index, and what happens to the light passing from one medium into the next. And that's taken advantage of. It's called Snell's law, for those of you who might remember it from, I don't know, high school physics. That's the basis for everything that we do in optics.
So these products, these inventions that you see, are they just purely for a commercial, let's say domestic use or industrial or other?
No, I mean, there are many different applications. And all around us, optical systems, optical effects. Take, for example, if any of us takes out our wallet and takes a look in there, and you take a look at your money, all the money you have in your wallet, well, every single banknote you have in your wallet has a security feature, or actually several security features. The higher the value of the note, some of those notes can have up to 7 security features on them. And these security features all exhibit so-called optically variable effects. And of course, for the companies that produce these banknotes, they have to try and stay one step ahead of the counterfeiters. And how do they do that? They do that by providing security features such as hologram patches or stripes or other optical structures, which are very difficult to reproduce. So the technology is such that manufacturer provides, it's called thin film technology. So precise deposition of metallic and non-metallic layers in a structured order on the banknote. I mean, these are small features. You can see it if you take out your banknote now, you can see. And this precise arrangement of these metallic and non-metallic layers gives rise to interference effects. And what happens then is that you have an angle-dependent color variation. If you take your banknote and you tilt it, I don't know, 20 degrees or something, you would see that you have color changes. On the 50 euro note, you can see that the color of the 50, the number 50 changes, and that's an optically variable effect. And that's, of course, a very important technology. And because it's literally the companies want to stay one step ahead of the counterfeiters. So they have to come up with new ideas to make these features more difficult to reproduce, because you need the measurements of the thin films are in nanometers. You need specialized equipment in order to produce these features. And basically the features are difficult to counterfeit. That's the question.
Yeah, I was going to ask you if you had seen any of the inventions that you've examined, but obviously you look at your money quite a lot.
Indeed, every night,
Every night.
Every night when I'm counting my money before I go to bed.
Lovely. I'm the opposite. I try not to spend any money whatsoever, so I don't I don't look at it. But actually, your story about the counterfeiting is really quite interesting. I remember an incident here in Vienna when representatives of a photocopying company came to show us their latest machine, and they explained that it was high resolution, high sensitivity, and really good reproducibility. So they asked us to see if we could test it. So I suggested we photocopy a 100 euro note and see what happened. And the end result was there was a photocopy with black stripes all over it. So it didn't look anything like a $100 note. So so the technology works.
Indeed, yeah. That's a relief for all the money-making companies, indeed, yeah.
So is any other areas of application of your work that, let's say, a consumer could identify with?
Yes, most certainly. So another area where many applications or patent applications that I look at are provided or we see very often is in the automobile industry. For example, at the moment, not just at the moment, this is a development we've seen over the past years, is a development of the so-called head-up display in cars. Well, wait, I should say that in the automobile industry, when you sit into your car, there are many optical elements around you. Again, you have light sources, again, LEDs, and this and that. But the most exciting development, I think, in my opinion, for the automobile industry is the so-called head-up display, which you find in many new cars nowadays. And the head-up display technology came originally from the military. So for pilots, the pilots have to deal with a lot of information all at once. And this head-up display was developed originally for airline pilots to facilitate their job as in the cockpit, receiving all this information. But nowadays in the automobile industry, that technology has been used and adapted to the car driver, basically. And it's a very practical invention. A display is provided under when you're sitting in your car and you've got the steering wheel in front of you. There you have the dashboard, and underneath the dashboard you have a display device, like an LCD display, for example, provided, which can project information that's relevant for the driver. It projects it upwards in the windscreen. There's an element provided which is called a combiner, which reflects the image towards the driver. So basically towards the driver's eyes, but it's a see-through display. So the driver can see outside. He can see the road. He can see all the everything around him, which is very important, of course, for road safety. But on top of that, he can see other information. For example, if you've put in a destination into your navigation system, well, the information is projected right in front of your eyes. Like, for example, in 200 meters, you need to turn right, or that there's a traffic jam up ahead, or that there's an obstacle up ahead, or most practically, I find, the speed limits for the area you're driving in at a given point in time is projected there. So it's a handy instrument to avoid getting a lot of speeding fines. So very practical.
So do you think this could be developed into the direction, first of all, something like you said there was an advance warning of a turn coming up? But do you think that could be adapted, say, in 500 meters, there's the next burger joint?
Yes, exactly. And other practical information like that. No, absolutely. I think that in the some cars already do provide that information, the so-called point of interest. So indeed, if you see, if you feel you're getting hungry, Nigel, you can look at those points of interest, and then all of that information can be displayed in the head-up display. Of course, there's also prioritizing of information. That's another development in the head-up display technology, because if, for example, a point of interest is being shown, I should also mention this information is displayed in the periphery. So the information that's being displayed will never, the aim is not to distract the driver from his main goal, which is to get to his destination safely. But indeed, if a point of interest is being displayed, such as the next Burger King joint, and then something more urgent comes up, like an obstacle on the road in front of you or a traffic jam, of course, there's prioritization of information so that what's displayed, the most immediate information which is needed for the driver is displayed before some less important feature like where he can get his lunch.
I mean, you could also think, just thinking off the wall a bit, you could combine this with infotainment and get the football results coming up, or maybe next time from a soap opera or whatever.
Yeah, well, you have to be careful not to distract the driver too much, Nigel. So we have to keep, I mean, in the end, these features, don't forget, they're all to improve or increase the safety of the drivers and the passengers and the other users of the road. So you might have to wait, or, you know, you can simply listen to the radio if you want to hear the match results, maybe.
That's fair enough, fair enough.
So, safety first, you know.
Safety first. So just a question about the actual job that you're doing. What's the most satisfying part of your job?
For me, the most, what's very satisfying is the fact that there's a great variety of subject matter. So a variety of technology too, even though it all falls under the title of optics. But I mean, I mentioned very few examples today, but we really deal with a large range of inventions, of applications. And this variety is very nice because you open up a file and you see something different, and also it's challenging. You can imagine this wide range of topics, and you also are informed about developments in the field and in the technology. So I like that aspect. Another aspect that I enjoy is anyone who's been listening to the podcast might have noticed we are, you know, an international organization, people coming from many different backgrounds, many different countries, all with different experience, also professional experience before they joined the EPO. So I find I also enjoyed that aspect of the job, which is the exchange with colleagues. You know, we're three people in the division, in an examining division, and this exchange is no, I'm lucky because in my field, at least, it's normally a very constructive exchange. And you really do learn through these exchanges. And when another pair of eyes looks at the application, you can also together find a way and you know, understand and find the best and the broadest scope of protection for the applicant, while at the same time, of course, fulfilling all the requirements of the EPC. So there are different aspects that I find enjoying, but I mean, I would say it could sum it up in the variety, both of the subject matter that we work with and as well as that the environment we work in. Yeah, that's it's exciting. Yes, it's and enjoyable. And a day doesn't go by when I don't learn something new. And I think that's important in life, isn't it?
Yeah, I think that's one of the aspects of working in this field. It's you learn something every day, as you mentioned. And I know that I've been at this for an inordinately long time, but I still learn something every day.
That's satisfying for sure.
So thanks very much, Orla. It's been very interesting to talk to you. You've had a fascinating career up till joining the EPO, and even also one that's really engaging as it comes across.
Yeah.
So thank you very much.
Thank you, Nigel. It was nice to talk to you today.
Subscribe to the European Patent Office's podcast channel, Talk Innovation, at epo.org. Or on your favorite podcast platform. Let's talk innovation.